Good afternoon and welcome to the first meeting of Session 6 of the Scottish Commission for Public Audit. I'm Colin Beattie, MSP. I'm the MSP for Midlothian North and Musselburgh, and as the oldest member of the Commission, I have the pleasure of chairing this meeting until we formally choose a chair. So we move to Agenda Item 1, which is Declaration of Interests, and the first agenda item is for each of us to declare any interests which we may have that are relevant to the work of the Commission. Background information on that is provided in the Declarations of Interest paper, paper 1. I will start with myself, and I have no relevant interests to declare. Sharon.
No relevant interests to declare.
Richard.
I don't have any declarable interests, but I would draw the Commission's attention to my voluntary entry in the Register of Members' Interests.
Mark.
Nothing to declare, Chair.
Daniel.
I would point members to my declaration of interest. In particular, I am a director of a company with retail interests. I'm also a trustee and vice chair of a charity, which is the ADHD Foundation. And just on that point, I was just wondering if I could ask for a clarification from the clerks. In terms of declarations of interest, is it not relevant to declare any governance or indeed audit roles that we might have with external organisations? And I was just wondering if members might want to reflect in terms of making those declarations.
So the SCPA is able to make its own procedures, although in practice it has generally followed the same procedure as the as committees. But it's for each member to determine to what they consider to be interest relevant to the remit of this commission.
Well, could I maybe just request that members reflect whether they do have any audit or governance roles with external organisations and maybe use this as an opportunity to declare those now?
Thank you. In that regard, I am on the audit committee of the Mining Museum, Scotland's National Mining Museum. Has anyone else got any audit that they would wish? Yeah, good. Then we move on to Agenda 2, which is the choice of a chair. So I seek nominations for that position.
Can I nominate Colin Beattie?
Thank you. Are there any other nominations? If members are content with my nomination as chair, we can move on to Agenda Item 3. Thank you. I look forward to working with you all. Agenda Item 3 is the choice of a deputy chair, and I'd like to nominate Sharon Dowie. If members are content to choose, I don't know if there are any other nominations, or if members are content to choose Sharon for the role of deputy chair, and if they are, I will move on to Agenda Item 4. Thank you. Congratulations, Sean. So we move on to Agenda Item 4, which is a decision on taking business in private. The Commission will decide whether to take Item 6 in private. Are we content to do so? Thank you. Then we move on to Agenda Item 5. Now, I think we should have witnesses someplace here. Ah. Now, Agenda Item 5 is evidence on Audit Scotland's annual report and accounts for the year to 31st March 2019. That cannot be correct. 2021. As well as the auditor's report on those accounts. Members have a copy of the annual report and accounts of their meeting papers. So welcome to the meeting, Professor Alan Alexander, who's Chair of the Board of Audit Scotland. And Professor Alexander is accompanied by Stephen Boyle, who is the Accountable Officer and the Auditor General for Scotland. Diane McGiffin, Chief Operating Officer, and Stuart Dennis, Corporate Finance Manager, Audit Scotland. Now, as our witnesses are appearing remotely, can I remind members that they should direct their questions to the Auditor General, who can invite witnesses to speak as appropriate. Should any of the witnesses wish to speak, please type R in the chat function, and I will bring you in at the appropriate time. So we'll welcome our witnesses, and perhaps I can invite Professor Alexander and then the Auditor General to make short introductory statements. Professor Alexander.
Thank you very much indeed, Chair. Before I introduce our annual report and accounts for 2021, I'd like to congratulate you and your colleagues on your appointments to this Commission and to welcome you to your posts. Over the years, we've had a very constructive relationship with the Commission, one that recognises your dual roles in holding Audit Scotland to account and in supporting us to deliver independent public audit that provides assurance to the people of Scotland and the scrutiny support to the Scottish Parliament and all of its committees. On behalf of my board and Audit Scotland's management team and staff, I look forward to working with you. Over the past year, Chair, the world we live in and work in has changed. As we've all gone through the upheavals on a scale not previously experienced, the importance of public services to the people and the people who deliver them could not have become clearer. I want to place on record my deep gratitude to all who have worked so hard during the COVID-19 pandemic for all they've done and will continue to do as we recover and rebuild. At Audit Scotland, like many other organisations, we've experienced 18 months of operating as a virtual organisation. We've had to find new ways to communicate, to support public audit. As with many organisations, the pandemic has resulted not just in finding ways to get through, but in true innovation and in developments that will result in permanent changes to the ways we work. I was struck time and again by the professionalism, empathy and resilience of Audit Scotland staff as they pulled together to get the job done and to support each other. We've been clear that our priorities have been the safety and well-being of our colleagues and robust independent audit. The board has focused on this, on driving this by ensuring good governance and oversight in these difficult times. Our role as a board is to oversee the exercise of all the functions of Audit Scotland. This means, crucially, ensuring that Audit Scotland effectively supports the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission to provide their scrutiny and assurance about public spending and public services, all of which are vital to everyone in Scotland. We've done this during a time when the board has gone through significant transition. If I may put this in context, Chair, of the five members of the board in post at the end of the 2019 to 2020 financial year, I am the sole remaining member. I came into post as Chair in April 2020, succeeding Ian Leach, who I thank for his stewardship over the previous 5 years. We've welcomed Elma Murray as interim Chair of the Accounts Commission onto the board, as well as new independent members Colin Crosby and Jackie Mann. I have to say that I look forward in the coming months to meeting both Colin and Jackie in person, but I have to emphasise that we have been very effective while working remotely. As you know, Stephen Boyle began his term as Auditor General in July of last year. I'll hand over to Stephen as Auditor General and our accountable officer in a moment. Before I do that, I would just like to record my thanks and appreciation for his leadership and direction of Audit Scotland over the past 14 months. It's something of an understatement to say that taking on both the leadership of a high-profile organisation and stepping into a crucial role in Scottish public life would have been, to use a word often used by public servants, challenging at the best of times, let alone during a global crisis. Stephen's calm, his resolve and his clarity have been invaluable, and as board chair, I am confident that Audit Scotland is in good hands. Convener, thank you. Let me now hand over to Stephen as Auditor General and Accountable Officer.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for your kind words. And just to record my own congratulations to Mr. Beattie and Ms. Dowie for their respective positions on the Commission. Before I talk about Audit Scotland and our activity over the 2021 financial year, I would also like to pause for a moment and record My thanks to key workers in the public sector and elsewhere for saving lives, supporting communities and help Scotland cope and address the impacts of the pandemic. As we became more used to living with COVID-19, it's important we continue to remember the incredible sacrifices so many have made on our behalf. As I say in my Accountable Officer's report, COVID-19 is the biggest challenge facing Scotland's public sector since devolution, and will continue to shape our landscape for many years to come. The pandemic has significantly increased both public spending and pressures that public services and public bodies are facing, which were already significant before the pandemic. The existing stresses from inequalities, climate change, increasing demand, new powers and changing demographics have all been exacerbated. This has significant impacts upon our work, our priorities and our approaches. Some of these are obvious, while some are still emerging, and the assurance we provide over public spending and the advice we give public services to help them improve is more important than it's ever been. Put simply, Chair, our job has got bigger and we have had to change and grow to make sure that we can provide Scotland and the Parliament with the public service it needs now and in the future. With the support of this Commission in the previous Parliament, during 2021, we have begun building and reshaping our capacity, skills and approaches to fit the new world. We reframed our performance audit programme that Audit Scotland delivers on behalf of myself and the Accounts Commission to ensure it is focused on the key issues that the public sector faces, it is flexible and responsive, and follows the significant amounts of public funding that have to address COVID-19's impacts, otherwise known as the pandemic pound. In the face of fundamental disruption to how we work and to how organisations we audit work, we delivered the financial audit of more than 200 public bodies to revise timescales and reshaping the scope of our audits where necessary to reflect the pandemic's rapidly emerging threats. Through all of this, we have prioritised our colleagues' well-being and safety and the rigour and independence of our audit work. Finally, Chair, I would like to pass on my thanks to all my colleagues at Audit Scotland and on our board for the support they have provided over the course of the past year. And as ever, Chair, we look forward to answering the Commission's questions this afternoon.
Thank you very much. I know members have a number of questions. What I would ask is if members ask all the questions that they have together. And I'll call Daniel Johnson to open up.
Thank you, Convener. Can I begin by sort of asking the big question? I mean, COVID-19 has clearly disrupted life over the last 18 months. But it strikes me, and has been alluded to by both Professor Alexander and Stephen Boyle, that it has had a sort of a fundamental impact on how you conduct an audit. I always think of auditing as requiring you at some level or other to be able to eyeball and assure what is on the accounts is actually there. Now, if you're working remotely, it strikes me that that is fundamentally interrupted. So just wondering, in broad terms, how has this impact on the ability to actually conduct audit? And actually, more importantly, I think we're all aware that COVID-19 isn't just a temporary impact. It has an impact that is likely to alter the way that we work in quite long-lasting ways. So what are, in terms of those changes that you faced this year, what are the ones that you see persisting? And obviously that will have an impact on the way Audit Scotland organises itself in the future. So just wondering if you could address those points, obviously firstly to Stephen Boyle.
Thank you. I'll start, Mr. Johnson, and I might invite Diane McGiffin to contribute as well after to say more about the experience of colleagues across Audit Scotland. We absolutely agree with you that COVID-19 has had a fundamental disruption to how we would have carried out our audit work. I think that's borne out in a number of places. So we've seen that essentially timescales have been extended for the completion of our audit work during the course of 2021. We were keen to kind of set the framework for that deadlines could be negotiated, but the audit quality and the well-being of our people couldn't. So we have now completed all of our 2021 audit work to extended timescales. They did take longer and to varying degrees, partly borne out from really the circumstances that audited bodies found themselves in, to an extent also that to the degree which they had invested in technology to support remote audit activity, and also recognising that neither Audit Scotland, the auditors that we contract with, nor public bodies had anticipated that by the middle of March last year, we would have switched to a remote audit function almost overnight. So that was borne out effectively in the longer timescales for the completion of the audit work, maintaining high focus on wellbeing and audit quality, absolutely. And we're now thinking really about what that means for the future. Like really nothing else in this environment, we're not entirely able to be confident in predictions as to whether we will snap back to how it took place our audit work previously or what the future will hold. But we're treating that really carefully, engaging with audited bodies and conducting regular discussion with our colleagues as we plan for the future, framed around our new strategic improvement programme that sets out how we will ready ourselves for the years ahead. And we're thinking very carefully on a number of fronts in terms of the investment we want to make in specialist skills, new technologies, our digital auditing work, all of which to kind of set out, you know, what will be our stall and probably a realistic assessment, as much as I'm able to do, that we expect that there will be a position of hybrid working across our audit work in the years to come. I think that probably gives an overall flavour of our thinking, but I'll pass to Dan McGiffin, who can maybe say a little bit more as how our teams have felt over the last year.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Commission. I think the issue you touched on first is about how we exercise professional scepticism in the environment of remote working. And I think for our teams reflecting back on the year, one of the things which has been helpful is that we are in the final years of the audit appointments that we have, and teams had already built up strong relationships and understanding about the business of the public bodies that they're auditing without compromising their independence. Those things are key. There is absolutely no doubt that auditors want to taste and smell an organisation, to get a feel for what's going on, and have found innovative ways to do that remotely. But they're not, some of those ways are not ways that would be first choice if we have the option of working in a different environment, which we're moving into just now. So as a profession, the auditing profession is looking very carefully at what remote working means for exercising professional scepticism and also for the training and development of auditors. We ourselves in our graduate training scheme are looking closely at that and how coaching and mentoring and learning the craft of auditing can be developed and undertaken properly when not everyone is in the same place at the same time and we move into a mode of hybrid working. Among the other issues that we'll be taking into account as we look at what we can retain from what we've learned over the past 18 months are the many downsides of travel, balancing that up with the many plus sides of direct engagement with bodies. We have our environmental targets, our environmental goals to meet. We'll be thinking very carefully, as the previous commission signalled to us, we'll be thinking very carefully about our property portfolio for the medium to long term and what some of that means, and also thinking very carefully about the use of technology. One of the things that we've learned over the course of the past year is the importance of our own investment in technology, but also the limits of the investment in technology that public bodies have made in enabling us to complete accounts effectively. We've engaged closely with colleagues throughout the year. We've conducted 10 pulse surveys to understand how people were finding different elements of working through the pandemic. And we've currently got our third how people think they want to work type working preferences survey open. We have a comprehensive quality agenda in the coming year, which will pick up some of these issues as we move forward. So I hope that's an answer in the round, thinking about professional scepticism and how to exercise it in a hybrid mode, developing our training scheme and our coaching and mentoring of graduate trainees in particular, but thinking long term about our environmental footprint and property portfolio to make sure we retain the innovations that we've developed over the past year.
Thank you very much for those answers. I think it provides us with a good overview as to the challenges and changes that COVID brings. And having started with the macro, I hope you'll forgive me for diving straight into the micro. And looking at your accounts for this year, there are a number of variances which I might expect, a decrease in stationery and an increase in IT spend. But two line items just jump out at me. First of all, a 44% increase in rent and rates, and I just would like an explanation, because that's obviously not just in percentage terms, but in actual terms, quite a large increase, and especially at a time when people were using buildings less, I'd be keen to understand why that occurred. And likewise, staff recruitment, again, up by 44%, which in actual terms may or may not be a significant amount, but obviously I just would be concerned if that indicated underlying staff churn, or just I would be interested in an explanation as to why staff recruitment costs increased so significantly in the year.
Thank you for those questions. I'm happy to start, and we'll absolutely invite Stuart Dennison to supplement any of my contributions. I'll maybe kick off on the rent and rates point, Mr. Johnson, and essentially we have limited flexibility as the Commission may be aware in terms of our rental costs. We lease three of our offices in Edinburgh, Inverness, Glasgow, and that's kind of partly reflects our flexibility and alludes to the point that Diane mentioned in our previous response about the Commission's request as we evolve our thinking into the future about making most efficient use of our office estate. But to kind of speaks to really the in part the inflexibility that we have in dealing with those costs. We'll also, as you've incurred additional expenditure in our staff recruitment over the course of the year, we have embarked upon additional recruitment. I wouldn't recognise that considerable churn in our staff. I think the market for auditors will always remain difficult at certain grades, but that we look to give all of our colleagues the right experience, and talked about a real focus on well-being over the course of the past year. But there are inevitably some costs that we incur as we look to broaden our reach, and particularly part of our work over the course of the past year in our thinking on diversity and equality, that as an organisation we're reaching out to as wide a talent pool as possible across the country. So all of those kind of factors play into those costs, but Stuart can maybe come in and just give a little bit more detail behind those two numbers. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. What I can add to what the Auditor General has said there is, in respect of recruitment, I'll start with that one first. We are in the process of a building capacity phase, and that started. We got additional funding approved by the SCPA in January, and we were looking to build capacity, and that was the cost of the recruitment campaigns to front load that. So we would get the staff in at the early point of this new financial year, which we did do with them onboarding in May and June. So that's the reason behind that. And as the Auditor General said, there's no real underlying churn of staff in respect of that. What I would add in respect of the rent and rates, absolutely correct, is a big increase there. The main reason behind that is we've got a provision in the accounts for a rent review in respect of our Westport office. The rent review was due on the 1st of April 2020. And just as we were looking to finalise our accounts at the end of April, we heard from the landlord's agent in April 2021 with a proposed significant increase as part of the rent review. So this is a provision at this stage, and we're currently in negotiations to finalise what the review will be for Westport.
Thank you. I'll end my questions there, Camina.
Thank you. Sharon Dowie? And if you could keep the questions and answers fairly concise, we have a tight time.
Okay. Hi there. On Audit Scotland's work programme, we know because of the impact of the pandemic the reasons for changing focus, but if you could give us further information on how parts of the former work programme were identified as suitable to be deferred or cancelled, and how the board assures itself that any risks or issues in these areas have not subsequently deteriorated.
Thank you. I'm happy to kick off, actually, and I'm sure Professor Alexander will want to say about the board's assurance in respect of the work programme. As the Commission will be aware that Audit Scotland carries out the work programme on behalf of myself as Auditor General, the Accounts Commission for Scotland to oversee local government work, and really in very early throes of the pandemic, I guess for a number of fronts, we paused the delivery of our work programme. One was in respect of, at that point in March and April 2020, the availability of public bodies to interact, to provide us and with evidence to clear reporting was really compromised. And, you know, we recognise with sensitivity about the extent to which we're able to meet our responsibilities of providing assurance over public funds, but particularly mindful of how life was at that moment, the extent to which the availability of really of senior people and, as I say, Ms. Dowie, they're available to interact with the audit programme wasn't what it would have been. We also looked at the detail of the work programme and took a view about where our resources were best spent. So we had a report due in respect of skills planning, which was due to be completed in towards the end of 2020. And also we had a report due almost for publication at that point on education outcomes and school education. That report has now been completed. But their main aspiration for pausing the work programme was to reflect the huge sums of public money that were coming to Scotland, over $9 billion as eventually transpired during 2020-21. And mindful of our role that as and when the immediacy of the pressures and availability of officials and public bodies eased, that we were able to interact and provide assurance to the Parliament that how well that public money was being spent, the extent of risk and issues that public bodies were facing. So we took a little bit of time over the summer to reframe our work programme so that it was both agile and responsive and reflected all of the issues. Myself and the Commission now have a quarterly refresh process around our work programme so that we keep it under regular review to flex items into the programme, defer others where we think necessary, and then also look at timescales. Of course, I look forward to discussing this with the Public Audit Committee tomorrow when we can say a bit more detail about how we have prioritised and identified our programme. But I hope that gives you a sufficient overview of the thinking at the time. And I'll maybe hand over to Professor Alexander, who may want to say about how the board has reassured himself of that process.
Thank you, Stephen. I think the question goes right to the heart of a very important distinction in how we work, and that's a distinction which I'm sure the Commission will recognise between governance and management. The management of the business, ensuring that it gets the work done, is the responsibility of Stephen as accountable officer and the rest of the management team and the entire staff. Governance is the responsibility of the board. And in overseeing the work programme, we have no, as a board, we have no input into what is in the work programme. That is the responsibility of the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission. Our responsibility is to ensure that Audit Scotland provides them with the expertise and, quite frankly, the labour that's necessary to do a high-pressure job. In doing that, we rely on a tiered system of scrutiny, utilising both of our committees, the Remuneration Committee and particularly the Audit Committee and the Board. And in that context, the role of the independent members of the Board, which is to say myself, Colin Crosby and Jackie Mann, is particularly important. I say this because the composition of our board means that two members of the board are also, as it were, customers of Audit Scotland. And so in that context, the extent to which the board in its various forms crawls over the work programme and indeed everything else about the running of Audit Scotland is very important. And I think that the independents in particular bring a remarkably wide range of professional experience to that role. And I think I can say with some confidence that the our colleagues in management and the staff know that they are being scrutinised. They appreciate the extent to which board members inform themselves of what's required of Audit Scotland and ensure that that is delivered. I'm happy to go into any other detail if members of the Commission require it. Thank you, Chair.
I think we need to keep this fairly tight. We need to keep this fairly tight as far as the length of answers and questions are, otherwise we're not going to get through. I think Diane McGiffin wanted to come in on this.
Apologies, Chair, it was on a previous question. It was just to say on turnover, on page 49 of our accounts, you'll see our turnover rate was 5%, which was slightly down on last year, just to provide assurance to the Commission on the earlier question.
Thank you. Sean?
Okay, if I can go into internal audit arrangements, on page 37, Audit Scotland confirms that 5 of the 6 internal audits in 2020-21 achieved substantial assurance. If you could give us a bit further information on the reasons for and its response to the 1 internal audit receiving a reasonable assurance conclusion from the BDO.
I'll maybe pass straight to Diane McGiffin on this point to provide the Commission with a bit of detail. But before I do that, I'd say that in overall terms, I think we are recognising the huge value that our internal auditors provide, and particularly very pleased in governance terms about the assurance that provides over the course of 5 out of 6, providing that substantial assurance, recognising the difficulties, the remote working, and the solidity, as it were, of the control environment during that period. But Diane can say a little bit more about that one, what they didn't quite reach top marks.
Thank you. Thank you. The audit, the internal audit under discussion is the IT procurement internal audit. It received reasonable assurance on design and on operational effectiveness. There were 3 low-level issues for us to adopt, and one of medium interest. Those were about updates to the handbook for procurement. They were about having an independent digital procurement policy and practice, and about liaison between different parts of Audit Scotland. All of those actions have been completed or are in train, and in fact, immediately prior to this meeting, we were in the audit committee reporting back on progress against internal audit actions, including those ones. The other audits all received substantial assurance on both design and operational effectiveness, and for information, covered business continuity planning, performance audit and best value adoption quality standards, preparedness for changes to the Audit Scotland Board and for the Auditor General, preparing for responding to reviews of the audit profession, and also IT strategy and service capacity. Thank you.
Okay, jumping on to the year-end financial position. If you could give a further explanation on why the final budget position, identified as £1.5 million in January 21, improved significantly by March 2021, and was the funding made available but not then required returned to the Scottish Consolidate Fund? And also whether the £1 million in savings delivered in 2020-21, if you think that will reoccur in subsequent years, or do you think it's a one-off?
I'm sorry, Ms. Dow, your microphone cut out for us halfway through your question. Most grateful if you could repeat it.
No further. On the year-end financial position, to see why the final budget position identified as 1.5 million in January 2021 improved significantly by March 2021. And the funding made available but not then required was that returned to the Scottish Consolidate Fund, and whether the 1 million in savings delivered in 2020-21 on page 30 will reoccur in subsequent years, or is it a one-off underspend perhaps due to the pandemic?
Thank you for that. I'm happy to start, actually, and I'm sure Stuart and maybe also Diane would want to contribute. I think I'll maybe focus my answer on the £1.5 million pound additional budget allocation that Audit Scotland requested and gratefully received from the former Commission at the end of last year. It was a really difficult point that our finances and our financial reporting is based on an annual cycle. As an organisation, we're not able to hold reserves and we are obliged to break even. Our income, and particularly our income from the delivery of audit work, was compromised by the pandemic, and the fact that our ability to recognise income was severely constrained. So when at the time of the request of the budget uplift from the Commission, we were under a significant prospect of not breaking even, and all of the ramifications of not complying with legislation qualification of our accounts. As the remainder of the year progressed, part of the restrictions eased and we were able to complete additional work on that meant that we were gratefully able to break even. And as we said at the time, that any underspend would be returned to the consolidated fund. I'll maybe just a word before inviting Stuart in about the efficiencies. And I think it goes back to some of the earlier conversation with Mr. Johnson, are really about there are some budget headings in our accounts that we have continued to underspend on, probably as expected, around travel, printing, stationery, subsistence rates, as we've moved away from being an audit organisation that's been out and about in public bodies to one that's been delivering our work remotely. And we're reviewing all of that, and particularly conscious that we, as recipients of public funding, and you know, as being Scotland's public auditor, we need to be as efficient as we possibly can. We need to demonstrate that to the Commission, to the Parliament, and users of public services. So it's very conscious of that as we remodel and change how we deliver our work, that we continue to be as efficient as we possibly can, but realistic at the same time. So whilst the efficiency savings under those headings are what they are in the accounts that we're looking at, probably an expectation that may come in, continue into next year, or it may be other budget headings that we'll look to flex. Nonetheless, we will want to be as efficient as we possibly can to deliver public audit through the use of public money that the Commission provides us. I'll maybe stop there and invite Stuart just to come in if there's anything he wishes to add to that response. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. Yeah, just a couple of points I can add in respect of the additional 1.5 million. We use robust assumptions to build a forecast of where we thought we would be come the end of the year. What happened is that based on that forecast of a budget, we spent 29.6 million. We actually, the outturn ended up being just about 2% of, so we were quite close overall on our forecast assumptions. Obviously things changed in respect of that. As the Auditor General said, we needed that assurance that we had sufficient to make sure we broke even at the end of the year, which we did. What I would add in respect to the savings, as the Auditor General said, I would confirm that some of them will be recurring in respect to possibly travel and subsistence will reduce. But like you said, some things will increase, and there are one-off savings as well incorporated in there. There's things like a small amount of capital that we didn't spend. So moving forward, I think there will be some are recurring, but a lot of it will be just a one-off in the year.
Can I just bring Mark Ruskell in for a quick question?
It's partially been answered, Chair, but yeah, the reduction in travel and subsistence was very significant. I mean, over half a million pounds, and I suppose it terms of your way of working going forward, how much do you expect to kind of bounce back, if you like, and to be doing much more travel and overnight work, you know, to engage with the public bodies that you're auditing? Or do you think some of the practices that you've developed, which are beneficial, are going to be sticky going forward? So just a bit of forecasting there in terms of how you intend to work going forward in relation to COVID, and whether in-person auditing and the extent of that you were doing previously is really going to be suitable to the way that you're going to be going forward, and how much money you need to do that.
Thank you. I'll maybe start. I'm sure Diane will want to come in to say a word or two. I think the short answer is, and I guess thinking about our opening statements, is that we don't expect to snap back to the ways of working that we had been deploying as an audit organisation in previous years. We used to have considerable travel. I myself personally was regularly using the Glasgow to Edinburgh train. Colleagues were travelling, you know, to all parts of Scotland by public transport, by cars, to have a physical presence in delivering our audit work. And some of that will still continue, and particularly as we need to get the audit evidence on the underlying financial records of public body, the evidence for to complete our performance audit programme. But I think if anything, the pandemic has taught us that there are alternatives to being there. We have delivered our audit work remotely successfully over the course of the past 16 months. And there'll be some thinking that we'll want to do as we move into the course of the next few years and deploying our Green Futures agenda too. So there's lots of thinking. We're careful about our sustainability and showing that there are alternatives way of doing it. We don't have a precise recipe yet as to kind of how we'll do one or the other, but it's undoubtedly captured our thinking to be more considerate and careful about our travel arrangements as we move forward. Mm-hmm.
Do you want me to continue other questions quickly, convener?
Is it on the same theme?
It's kind of building on the theme and moving on to something else.
Okay, briefly.
Okay. So, Diane, I think you mentioned earlier the point about the kind of seamlessness between, in terms of IT, or the lack of it, between yourselves and the bodies that you're auditing. And I'm just wondering to what extent that will continue to be a challenge going forward, or if you think that will get better. Now, that could slow down the auditing process. It could mean perhaps more in-person visits because you can't exchange the data that you need on an online format or whatever. I'm just interested in whether that's a bit of a headache at the moment, or whether that's something which will resolve itself as we get into this new normal of working more online.
Thank you. I think first thing to say is we have, we have the ability to determine our own IT, and we invest in that. And it's absolutely business critical for us as it is for others. I think there's a very mixed picture across public bodies. We've reported on that ourselves. What I'd say is we have a very good handle on the issues that technology has brought into all of the audits that we do, as do the audit firms who work with us. So where there are, we've managed to, a bit of assurance is, we managed to complete all of the audits in March this year. So we managed to find solutions to everything, and we will keep working at that. And I think it's, if it's difficult for us, it's difficult for the public bodies too, and we're very empathetic about that. And having discussions in our audit planning meetings with public bodies about what arrangements we'll put in place this week. I think in terms of your earlier question, when it comes to budgeting, we'll be coming back later this year with our budget proposals. My guess at the moment is we need to retain a bit of flexibility on travel and subsistence in order to build back new working practices, build back confidence in public bodies and in our teams about how to conduct the audits. But what we can guarantee to do is to make the assumptions that we're building our budgets on very clear for you. But I'm guessing on a number of points about budgeting, we will need to be thinking about flexibility to accommodate unexpected changes. Thank you.
A question about the home nation COVID-19 group that you've been part of, you know, sharing the experiences of public audit across these islands. Can you just sort of tell us what the main areas of learning have been from that? And is that something that's going to continue going forward? Is that group also benchmarking experiences outside of the UK as well?
Thank you for that question. We frame our engagement with the other UK audit agencies and also with the Republic of Ireland as part of the UK and Ireland Public Audit Forum. That manifests itself really across a number of different groups within those organisations. So myself and the other Auditors General meet twice a year, Diane and the other Chief Operating Officers, and then business leads, you know, really across all of our functions engage. So we have that opportunity for shared learning and experience. As you would expect, the main focus has been on COVID and the extent to which one organisation is sharing good practice. We find it to be an open and really helpful grouping that as public auditors and, you know, that we are the as distinct from the auditing profession focused exclusively on delivering public audit, that's a very helpful group. It's been in place before the pandemic and it will continue to do so. As I mentioned, the COVID-19 has been the real focus of those discussions. How to flex our programme, really, I suppose, touching on the answer to Ms. Dowie, that like the other audit agencies, Audit Scotland paused its Forward Buck programme, flexed it to look at it become both agile, flexible and responsive, something very similar. The products and the assurance that have come from that, particularly the COVID trackers, the briefing papers model, supplemented by the more traditional performance audit reporting, have all been discussed with ideas exchanged across the public audit forum. And the only other thing, just about, you'd asked about our reach beyond the UK and Ireland. We've had in Audit Scotland a fairly well embedded international engagement programme for many years now. That has clearly been curtailed in terms of travel and face-to-face engagement over the course of the pandemic, but we've still engaged with kind of online arrangements with many other audit agencies where appropriate over the course of the pandemic about sharing and learning as we aspire to be a learning organisation that can draw on experiences of other organisations. And we supplement that with colleagues' engagement with auditing accounting institutes across the world. So we're tapped in both developments in the accounting and the auditing profession in the UK, Ireland and beyond.
Thanks.
Sean, do you have anything else?
Okay.
Thank you. Richard Leonard.
Yep, thank you very much, Chair. So one of the things that struck me about the report was on page 20, which was looking at both internal and external quality assurance review. The conclusion was drawn that only 4 of the 11 financial audits achieved the target standard of quality, and of the remaining 7, 3 were graded as a quote improvements required, and 4 were graded significant improvements required. And I think the commentary also talks about mixed results. So my question is, could you give us further details of these mixed results? What are the particular areas for improvement? What is the seriousness of these? And what is the work plan to address them?
Thank you. I'll look to answer your question, Mr. Leonard. But Diane McGiffin may equally wish to come in to supplement, and even Professor Alexander, about the assurance that Audit Scotland's board has received on these matters. I think, as I say in my accountable officer's report, that in essence, the results weren't what we had hoped they would be. From the external quality assessment that took place on our financial audit. But stepping back for a moment, I would say is that we have been on we have a quality framework in Audit Scotland that covers our financial and all of our performance audit work. Its breadth is unique in the UK audit agencies and allows us to provide assurance to the Commission, to Audit Scotland's board, across all aspects of our work. In respect of the work that we report through our transparency and quality report each year, the results of the independent assessments that the Institute of Chartered Accountants for Scotland undertake comprise one component of it. I'll come back to that in a bit more detail in a second, but we also reflect in that report the results of surveys that we undertook with audited bodies on their experience of the audit, and also from Audit Scotland staff and the staff in firms who conduct public audit, and they play back that they've had more time to conduct public audit work this year, and the satisfaction of audited bodies has increased. Nonetheless, the results from some of our financial audits weren't what we would have wanted this year. We have implemented an improvement programme of 15 actions, capture the feedback that we received from ICAS, 13 of which have now been completed. We talked earlier about the additional investment that the Commission has provided to Audit Scotland this year, and we've used some of that money to invest in our quality arrangements. We've enhanced our team of in-year quality assessors so that we've got that early warning of any issues that are coming up. And really the essence of the issues that were identified by ICAS, none of which compromised the integrity of the audit, and importantly, the audit judgments, the conclusion that the auditors were making. Some of it was about process, some of it was about documentation that we have in our audit files. I hope the Commission can reassure that we take this really seriously. If we wish to, as part of our corporate plan, profess to be world-class public auditors, we need to receive feedback like this and action it. So we'll be continuing to report publicly through our transparency and quality report about the results of the independent assessments that will take place following the conclusion of this year's audit, and indeed it will start within the next few weeks. I'm delighted to keep the Commission updated on our progress.
Thanks for that answer. I'm sure it's something that we will come back to and keep an eye on. I think the other area that struck me, and I'm sorry I'm dwelling on the more of the negative than the positive today, but the other thing that struck me was the a couple of pages later, the section on professional training for audit, which had the statistics in there of pass rates, and I think the pattern is 2018-19 a pass rate of 85.7%. 2019-20 a pass rate down to 84%, and 2020-21 a pass rate down to 79%. And I think at a previous point there had been some suggestion that the reason for the variation might have been a change to the exam. A new exam, I think, was introduced a couple of years ago. But I wonder whether you could explore with us the reasons why you think this pattern is as it is. What you're doing to try and address it, and you know, do you have any insight into why you think this pattern is going in the direction it is?
Thank you for the question. I'm sure Diane will want to come in, actually, and I'll invite her to do so in a moment. I think the thing I would maybe say is we're not sure it's yet a long-term pattern. I think particularly the results of our trainees, really to be just shy of 80%, we think that's holding up pretty well and benchmarks well against the overall pass rate of ICAS trainees, of which all of our trainees are now completing compared to other providers. There's no doubt that 2020-21 was a tough year for all of our trainees. And specifically in terms of the exams, all of these exams were sat remotely using laptops and technology, as opposed to being physically in an exam setting. Our trainees have told us that did affect some of them, and there were some instances where the quality of home broadband facilities wasn't reliable on the day that allowed our impacted our trainees' performance. As an employer, we determined to be supportive and look after the well-being of our trainees. We have high expectations and standards of them, but nonetheless, we particularly recognise in this year that any conclusions would be too soon to draw based on exam performance. We wanted to give them the right environment and support to be successful as they progress through their training contracts with us. I think what the Commission can hopefully be reassured is that we treat the success and well-being of our trainees with really the highest priority, We are one of Scotland's biggest training providers for the ICAS profession. And we want to kind of we'll look after both them and look closely at these results as we move in across the rest of the year. Our main focus is on their success and the support that we provide them. But Dan may wish to say a little bit more about any more of the actions that we're taking.
Thank you. We have looked at the results in the round, both that snapshot at the end of the year and also the first quarter results for this year. And we have met with ICAS to understand what issues there are, if any, about the new curriculum that's underway, the new style of exams. We're thinking about our own support for trainees and how we learn and build on that. Our trainee cohorts have operated very strongly pre-COVID, and we're thinking about as an early action as we return to office working in some way, that rebuilding those connections for trainees so that they get that mentoring and relationship going, that's a very early priority for us as we move into the next phase of work. So we're getting right under the skin of it, but not sure yet that there's enough data to suggest this is a systemic problem for us, but it's definitely one that we take very seriously. We want to give people an absolutely brilliant experience as graduate trainees, and that's what we're focused on. We have a team of people across the business who support and mentor trainees, and we are working very closely on this and be very happy to give you updates later in the year.
Thank you.
Right, I've got one or two questions myself. I'm conscious that we may not get through them all by 1:30, which is our drop dead time. I'll ask you the first one is about working remotely. You've touched on this already, but what is the impact that this has had on staff and their ability to deliver the financial audits and the performance audit work programme to a level that is of a high standard?
There's no doubt it's been challenging. It's been tough for our people. Chair, we've all lived through the pandemic, and we've all had different experiences of it. And it's been particularly challenging, and we know this from our own personal lives and from what our colleagues have told us, where they've done so whilst dealing with caring responsibilities, particularly homeschooling, and the impact that that's had. We knew really early on that that was going to have an impact on the deliverability and the timescales that we had been operating. Across the piece, and really that kind of led us to the part of that earlier conversation about the need for the financial support to in order for Audit Scotland to break even. As Diane mentioned earlier, we've had extensive communication and engagement so that we are living up to our professions, that we are prioritising the well-being and quality, well-being of our colleagues and the quality of our work. Regular pulse surveys, communication through our incident management team on a weekly basis, blogging, feedback sessions, all of which to make sure that we understand and can take the necessary responses. But it's been a disruptive, challenging year, and I think we're still, as many organisations, figuring out about what the future now brings as restrictions ease across the country.
Now, I assume that the board is overseeing the evaluation of the robustness and effectiveness of remote working, both in terms of the quality and so on of the work done and the well-being of the staff concerned. So is there a reporting mechanism to the board for this?
I'll let Mr. Professor Alexander say it in a minute. Yes, we've reported at every meeting of the board and the audit committee. COVID-19 is a standing item on our agenda, and in those conversations, we update the board, we answer their questions and feedback about how remote working is impacting upon all of our colleagues. We touched briefly on the pulse surveys, the engagement sessions that we've had, and we've also continued to carry out our annual survey of colleagues who are our best companies. We were delighted in that regard to receive our best ever result from Audit Scotland colleagues and to be categorised for the first time as a one-star organisation. And much of that is based on the experience that people have had over the course of the year. But Professor Alexander may wish to say a word or two more.
Thank you, Stephen. Maybe the best way into this, Chair, is just to say that at the beginning of the pandemic, when we were all feeling our way through a dark tunnel, it seemed to me that we did not have we didn't have enough meetings to give the kind of scrutiny that was required. By that I mean that we normally have a gap between June and September. And I insisted on a board meeting taking place in August in order that we could immediately monitor how well we were doing, where we were doing things well, where we were doing things less well, and what we had to do to change the pattern. Now, that approach has continued, and as Stephen said, we have looked at all aspects of the impact of COVID at every meeting, not only of also of the Audit Committee, and we're relevant to its remit, the Remuneration Committee. I mentioned in my introduction, or in this question, the breadth of experience that I have access to with my two co-independent members. And I think that over the last year, that has been remarkable in this experience of other organisations under other kinds of pressure to ask the kind of questions which don't put the management under undue pressure, but ask the kinds of questions that allow us to be confident that we are giving good governance to a very difficult set of management decisions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for that. We have run to the end of the time for this particular session. There's still one or two questions which certainly I would like to ask. I propose to send them up to you in writing if you'd be so kind as to come back to us on them. So at this point, I'll thank all the witnesses and draw this session to a close and suspend for a few minutes for the next panel. Right, so we now... We now have our second panel, and I'll welcome the witnesses from Alexander Sloan, Steve Cunningham, partner, Gillian So, Audit and Accounts Manager, both from Alexander Sloan.
Do you want to just pause the meeting? Because we're not going
to... Can we just pause for a second? I think there's somebody missing, is there? Okay. We're good again. So I welcome you both to the meeting, and I'll invite members to direct questions to Stephen. Stephen, if you could bring in Gillian as appropriate. I've got a couple of questions which I'll ask you initially, just for the official record. Can Alexander Sloan confirm that you've received all the necessary information and explanations that you require to form your opinion on the financial statements?
Good afternoon, Chair and Committee. Yes, I can confirm that is the case, and can confirm that the audit of Audit Scotland was completed without any limitation in the scope of the audit work. If I may, I'd just like to give a quick overview of our work.
Okay.
Alexander Sloan were appointed by the committee to carry out the external audit of the 2021 financial statements of Audit Scotland. Given the year, we attended all Audit Committee meetings of Audit Scotland. With COVID restrictions, our work was done remotely this year, but I can assure the committee that working remotely did not impact us in gaining sufficient evidence, and the audit was completed without any significant problems. As part of our work, we've also reviewed all internal audit reports during the year and held discussions with Audit Scotland's internal auditors, BDO. In accordance with the firm's quality control procedures, the audit file was also subject to a second part of the review. The review was carried out by our senior partner prior to signing of the audit report. All our audit was carried out in accordance with international standards in auditing, and as mentioned earlier, we received all information and explanations we required to form our opinion. And based on our opinion, based on our audit work, we form an opinion on whether the accounts give a true and fair view, whether they've been prepared in accordance with international financial reporting standards, as interpreted and adapted by the financial reporting manual, confirm that they've been prepared in accordance with the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act and directions by Scottish ministers. We were satisfied with all 3 points and issued an unmodified audit report. In other words, we were satisfied the accounts do give a true and fair view and in accordance with legislation and accounting standards. And the audit report and accounts were signed on the 8th of June. We also prepare a management letter based on our audit findings, and the purpose is to summarise the key issues arising from our audit and to report any weaknesses in accounting systems and internal controls that come to our attention. I can confirm there was no such weaknesses were identified during the course of the audit. Finally, I just would like to thank the staff at Audit Scotland and support staff of the SCPA just for the assistance during the audit this year. Thank you.
Thank you for that additional reassurance. Now, just one other question, which is, Audit Scotland's made certain accounting estimates which are material to the overall income and expenditure in 2020-21. Work in progress of 1.287 million is included as income on the basis of a judgment of work completed but not yet charged to audited bodies. Audit Scotland also created a COVID-19 provision at a cost of £886,000, which is a judgment, again, of extra fees payable to external firms due to the additional time spent on the audit of certain public bodies. Now, these obviously require detailed consideration and scrutiny by the auditors, and I would just like you to confirm that you're content with the judgments made by Audit Scotland and the disclosure of these in the annual report and accounts.
Yes, we are. A significant proportion of the audit is looking at both of these areas, both work in progress and provisions, and we do make sure the work's carried out in accordance with international standards in audit, and we were happy with the work performed, and the figures stated in the account.
Thank you. Can I ask if members have any questions they would like to ask Alexander Sloan? Sharon?
Hi there. So Alexander Sloan's work on the audit of Audit Scotland's annual report and accounts was delivered remotely during the period of government restrictions and guidance to work at home where possible. Could you tell us about the changes to Alexander Sloan's approach to the audit so we can understand the challenges that remote auditing presented and the impact that it had on the audit approach?
I'll start off with Julie might want to come in and add points to that. This is the second audit we've had to carry out for Audit Scotland working remotely. Last year we could carry out the interim, but the final audit field work was done remotely. We have made use of technology so we can hold meetings remotely, we can view screens at Audit Scotland. But we can certainly assure you that we've managed to still get all of the audit evidence that we require. There's certainly no changes in what we require as auditors to be able to sign off the audit report. So we were happy we still managed to get all of the evidence required. Billy, is there anything you want to add to that?
I would just say this is the second year that we've been working remotely with Audit Scotland, and any information that we requested was provided to allow the smooth flow of audit information. And so we didn't experience any issues with remote working on the Audit Scotland audit.
Okay. With you working remotely, has it led to any beneficial innovations in the audit process which could be adapted going forward?
Yeah, I think certainly there's been far greater use of technology, and I think those aspects will carry on in terms of audit going forward. We previously had the use of photos and things to help safe transfer of information, but the use of technologies for meetings and being able to view screens remotely has certainly helped the audit this year, and there'll be aspects from that getting carried forward for future audits.
Thank you. Do any members have any other questions? Yes, Mark.
I mean, just briefly, convener, on the back of that, previous discussions we've had with Audit Scotland, they talked about the importance of being able to audit an organisation, get a taste and smell of the organisation, in their words. Are you confident you're able to get a taste and smell of them through doing this work remotely, or do you think there are things where you, in hindsight, you think actually we could have gone with going in there and spending a bit more time on X or Y or doing things slightly differently?
I think certainly similar to Audit Scotland, we have been audited for a number of years, so we do have a good understanding of the organisation, so that's certainly helped. We also employ a very senior team to carry out this audit. So I think with that and the use of technology, we're happy that we did get that assurance, and yes, we could smell the organisation and taste it, and we had the proper feel for carrying out that audit. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you. Stephen, is there anything that you would like to add before we draw this session to a close?
Nothing further.
In that case, I'll thank both of you for your attendance. And I'll draw this session to a close, and we will move into private session.